Hello, everyone. Welcome back to the EA Global Summit 2020. This is Nizam from the organizing team. And with us, we have Bird, an independent architect from EA Expertise, and he'll be presenting on HTML generation in EA. This is following a brilliant session by Bird yesterday on data modeling, details of which is available in the Teams forum as well. So just a quick note on questions and discussions regarding this session. We have a Teams channel set up, as you may already know. Please join the channel and raise your questions, or if you would like to have a discussion with Bird, who will be available after the session in the Teams platform. The link to the Teams channel will be posted in the chat window during the session. We thank you once again for joining the session, and I now request Bird to continue the excellent presentation. Over to you, Bird.
Okay, let's see. Thank you very much, Nizam, for offering me this, this opportunity to do this presentation on HTML publication. HTML publication is a functionality which is relevant for a lot of organizations, and an enterprise architect does offer some basic functionality. But what I often see within my pool of customers is that there is often something more needed. In this session, I will present two solutions I developed for different customers. One is a different static generator, part of the ID add-on, and the other one is the WPP, the open source dynamic viewer for enterprise architect repositories. I am Bert Ingemans, independent data architect, as Nizam already mentioned, based in the Netherlands and working for a number of organizations, mostly in creating data models, but also quite often in creating Archimate models. I am one of the participants in the Expertise initiative. It's a small group of enterprise architect consultants who are working together on various products and on various solutions and services. I show you here our website. It's mainly in Dutch, but for English speaking people, there is an English in an English page where you can find a brief summary of the services we are offering. And for this session today, there are two relevant aspects what you can see in this page, is that we are offering two open source products. The first one is the web publication platform. That's what we will discuss in detail later in this session. And the other one is the IDEA add-on. And the IDEA add-on is a DLL which you can connect with an enterprise architect solution. And in this solution, I will show you how you can create and how you can modify your dynamic, your HTML pages generated based on a package. So in the first part of the session, I will demonstrate the static HTML generation with the IDEA add-on, and in the second part, I will demonstrate the web publication platform. On each page, you will see that there are a number of links available. Here is a live demo of the IDEA sample. It's a combination of the web publication platform and the data model and the HTML generator. Here is also a download option where you can download the add-on and eventually the sample repository I am using today. So when you use this download button, you will go to a registration page where you have to fill in your email address, and then you will receive an email with all the details about how to install the add-on and how to use the HTML generator. Some sample screens in this. for the web publication platform, there is a same structure. There's also a web page with all the details of the product, also an open source product, same structure, description of the product, and here again, the possibility to download the source code of the WPP solution. Why are we working with open source products? Well, that's quite logic from our perspective. The community is a group of organizations who are working together on defining functionalities for the different products, for example, for the WPP, but also for the IT. And what we do there is that we say, well, there is a certain functionality needed, for example, for one of the participating companies. And when they say, well, we are interested in it, I develop that part of that functionality for that customer, but afterwards we publish all the material for all the partners in the community so that they can share the functionality which is added. That's one of the reasons why I am demonstrating this today, because what we hope is that you are enthusiastic about the product and when you want to use it and want to extend some functionality, is that you are willing to contribute in the community. However, if you're not an active community member, you can always download the material we created and you can use it in your own solutions, but then you don't have influence on the functionalities we create. The website, the installation, I already mentioned two pages where you can find all the detailed information and two live demo sites, which I will demonstrate later, where you can find all kinds of extra information like web videos, some white papers, and some extra scripts and tips to use the products we are showing today. Well, let's go to the first solution, the static HTML. The static HTML generator of Spark Enterprise and Architects is, as I already mentioned, it's really basic. But one other aspect is, well, that you can modify the templates, but that is quite challenging because the structure, well, I didn't really consider it really clear what's happening in the various steps. So for one of my customers, we decided to create a static HTML generator, which is strongly based on SQL statements for accessing the data in the repository. But on top of that, we created a solution where you can add your own layout to your HTML pages, because that is also one of the aspects of the basic HTML generator in EA, is that it's quite difficult to generate your own style, your own style sheets to web pages. Here in the samples I will demonstrate today, we have created two samples, both based on the Bootstrap framework, and the Bootstrap framework is really helpful when you want to create a website which is also good viewable on, for example, a mobile phone or another small device. It's easy to extend the templates, and what we can do, I will show that later, is that you can easily extend the templates and then save the extensions to an XML file so that your new definitions are available for later use. I suggest we go to the first example. It's based on the IDEA add-on. The IDEA add-on you have to install. When you have registered, you will receive an email. You can download a setup file. When you run that setup file as an administrator on your computer, you have it available and you can check it here under add-ins. When it's well registered, it's in the list of the add-ins, but it's also here as a button available. The static HTML generator is based on generating data, an HTML page from a certain package. Here we have the sample repository used today. And what I will do today is I will create a sample website for an example data model. I'm in the browser, in the EA browser, and I'm going to IDEA and I select the browser helper. And here you see a page where it's possible to generate two types of outputs of publishing. The one is a PDF generator or a doc generator. You can generate a PDF generator based on the document generator in EA, but with some small changes is that you have the possibility to modify the structure of how the document is created and what the order of the various elements is in the document. And here you see a small sample. This is what one of my customers asked, if they want a report based on a package, a diagram, and then the elements in the diagram. But that was quite a challenging question. They wanted to have the elements in the documents sorted based on the order of the elements in your diagram. So it had to be displayed, elements had to be displayed from left to right and from top to bottom. And this is what it's made possible here. For now, we are looking at the HTML publication. You can say, well, what is the start page we are going to start with? You can say, well, when you create an HTML page, a static HTML page, I will also want you to create a PDF page for you. I will show you later why this is interesting. We can create composites, diagrams clickable. When there are composites, for example, for BPMN diagrams, you also often have composite diagrams. Here you can make those composite elements clickable and you can create it in the browser. What I did earlier before the session is that I already created this, this page, and I can show it here. Here is the sitemap. It's really a simple sitemap. You see the example of the data model with the nodes. I have a simple structure of my diagrams. I have a simple Bootstrap layout. I can go to a home page, but here you see that I can go to a diagram and I can navigate to one of the elements. And when I want, I can also go to a package diagram. Here, and what you see here is that there is a hyperlink for a PDF document. What the routine does is when you specify it in the screen, is it generates a PDF document on the background for every package that has a number of diagrams or a number of elements in them. So packages with only sub-packages, there is no PDF for created. But here you see that I can create a PDF document for each package which has diagrams. And here you see the sample, you see what it has generated, really simple structure. But often for people really interesting, they have a navigation possibility here, but for the details of the elements, they have an overview in this package document. I go back to the generator screen, because what is here behind is that for every element, there are a number of templates generated. When you start using the IDEA add-on, it will create this basic template. It creates a page template, a detail of a package. And here you see what is the body template, the body template, what is the select statement for this element, eventually a footer for the element. And here you can see, well, I can here add a piece of HTML code, and then I put placeholders for certain elements to add these elements. And then when the generator starts, it will see for every HTML section whether there are content placeholders. These content placeholders are related with one of these elements here. For example, here you see list packages package, and here I can say, well, list package package, and here you see a simple script of how to add a list of HTML links for the various packages within a package. List diagram package, that's the one we saw before. Here you see an example of this element. You see here the list of hyperlinks for the diagrams, and eventually I can also do this for the elements I'm using. For the elements, I can also create all kinds of details. And what I can eventually do is I can say, well, I want to update this element, because what I want to do here is I want to add a list of attributes for elements, and I can update this, and I can add a new one, this one, list attributes elements. And here I have created a small section in my presentation. Here I have a number of items, and I go back to my HTML page. Here is the header. This is my select statement. And here is also a small part for my body. And for my footer, I have to add an end table. And I can have updated this. When I go back to my HTML publishing, I can say, well, let's start and generate again. Some minutes. I didn't create the PDF document now, because that takes some time. And it's not, well, I already showed the elements I mentioned, and here I can say, well, let's check what the elements. And this one probably doesn't have. Let me see. The detail of the elements. Like this, update. Now it's there. Now I can generate it. So you see that on the background, all the documents, all the diagrams. Transferred to the testing notes. And here you see the combination of the full name and here the elements of the attributes. This is the basic solution for generating HTML pages. There is a possibility to create and a little bit more advanced example. I will load the advanced template. I have to save the settings after this. Well, it's still running. Well, we have to wait very long. What is there? But it's okay, for the sake of time, I will get back to this later. What I suggest is that we continue at this moment with the WPP. The WPP is a web application platform for enterprise architects, but it has a little bit a different approach. It is an ASP.NET application which connects to a repository via a SQL connection, via a connection string, so you go have access right to the database of the EA repository, and now you have the possibility to navigate it in a different manner, but in a real time manner. And for some situations, this is really interesting. In the solution I'm offering for this conference, there is the source code is included. You can load it in Visual Studio and you can run it right away. Here is the solution which is running straight to the EA repository, and here you see that you have the possibility to create an intuitive and attractive layout based on Bootstrap. But what you have here is there are a number of elements which are interesting when you have direct access to the repository. For example, I can do some searching, and that's in static HTML solutions a little bit more difficult. For example, when I say, well, what is available on address? And since I'm using the AdventureWorks database as a sample of my data model, you see here that I have a number of entities. And what I can say here, well, let me see the details of this element. And when it's loaded, you see here the element, the description of the element you see here the attributes which are available in here. Here you see on which diagram the element is displayed. And of course, this can be more diagrams. And you can say, well, to which other elements this element is connected. So here I can go to the diagram. I can look at the diagram. It is constructing a diagram page with all the details there. You see here the diagram. It's a physical data model. You see here a number of entities. When there is a description, I can have added here two. And what I can do is can say, well, I'm also interested in this entity. I click on it. It will load. And it will display all the details about this element. And this is all done interactively. So this is really nice. So you can add this, for example, on a living database where people are modeling. And you can add this and give people who are not do not have access to Enterprise Architect, who are thinking that the Windows client of Enterprise Architect is too complicated, and you can give them access here. Yesterday, we did a lot of discussions about mappings, about creating mappings between different elements. And here you see also that it's possible to create a description of the various mappings within this entity related to other entities. So it's easy to extend this tool with display of data, which is not directly available within Enterprise Architect and its diagrams. So here you have a great help on creating your own dynamic viewer. I will get back to that later when I show you how easy it is to modify the structure of my WPP viewer. Here again, linked elements. Here you see that there are multiple diagrams. Different elements are, there is an advanced search window. And with this window, you have the possibility to search for multiple elements. You can select a kind of Boolean operators. You can say, well, I want to search in a number of specific fields. I want to filter out a number of stereotypes, or I want to be certain that the elements I'm searching for are available in one or more specific packages. So here you have the possibility to create a specific advanced search. This is especially relevant when you are working with a large repository where multiple packages are available. Overview, this is interesting. Here you have a different approach on getting access to the various parts of the repository. I can say, well, I want to see the packages, I want to see the diagrams, and I can click on that and it will give you a nice window, a nice overview of the diagrams which are available in this repository. And again, here is the possibility to do a filtering. And then it will only select out the diagrams which are relevant for me in this case. And here, somewhere there must be the word example. Here I can again go to the details. And at this moment, I have the same navigation as I had before with the search opportunity. Here I have the possibility to do some navigation again. I can again go to the elements on this diagram and go further to the elements I am interested in. For example, and I don't think that data modeling is the only environment in this, you want to have specific searches to elements of a certain type. Here you see an example. I have created a number of specific overview searches when I can say, well, I want to say, see only Archimate business objects. I only want to see Archimate data objects. I only want to see the logical data model based on the classes. And here two physical data models, the XSD elements and the tables. And when I say, well, I create one, I want to have one certain elements. I get a list of all the elements of a certain type or stereotype. So here, an extra specific filtering option in HTML based on a specific search in the database. And again, here, I can say, well, show me the details of this element and show me on which diagram this element is and onto which other elements this is connected. So every time the same navigation behind the elements. Specific for people who are not often using this model to see what's in there. It is kind of read only. Often you have people within your business who sometimes want to look up some information specific for their field of interest, specific for their viewpoint, their stakeholder view. You have the possibility to say, well, we want to navigate them to only the diagrams and only the elements which are relevant to them. And that's why we introduced the concept of start pages. Start pages are like a starting point for a certain view or a certain stakeholder and to see whether which information is relevant to them. Here you see a number of start pages which we created. Here you see the layers I already mentioned. Here you see a description of what ID is. It's a kind of background information. What I can say here as well, here I go to this start page and it will display me a short story about what the conceptual data model is and give some information about the viewpoints we defined. Here I have a connection to this overview search for business objects. And here I have access to a package where I can find extra information and examples, diagrams, etc. of the conceptual data model. Created that for also the other layers. And what's interesting is that you are able to easily modify and create new start pages within this WPP environment. So here I will navigate to one of my overviews. It shows me an overview of the classes. And here again, I see the classes which are relevant. An extra aspect which is available in the WPP is that I can go to a diagram or to an element. And for that element, I can create discussions. When I say, well, I see here that address type, I think it's not correct. I can start a simple discussion. I can say here, well, I think that the name is wrong. I can say, well, name is wrong. It shoots. The address category or whatever. And I can save it. And when I go back to my page, because I'm running it local, I'm not able to send an email, but when you run it on a web server where also mail is configured, it will also send an email because, well, what we have created here is that there is a possibility for a moderator to keep a view, an overview of what discussions are taking place on the WPP. And the WPP, it can be that there are people who are saying things which are not relevant on this site. Well, the moderator has the possibility to hide discussions which are not relevant on this site. Here you see that there are a list of discussions. I can go to one of the elements, and here I also have the possibility to do to give some replies. So when I say, well, I think it's correct, I can add here the elements to the discussion. So you will get a list of replies and a list of discussions. Combination here, I think it's really powerful for doing this on this in this approach. And for this, we have to have the possibility to create members. On the home page, we created an element where you can say, well, I want to become a member in this WPP. You have to register yourself, and later you are able to log into this site. And when you are able to log in, you also have the opportunity to do the discussions. Some extra functionality, what is available. There is an Explorer view where you have the possibility to load a tree view. It's a little bit like the project browser style. I have the possibility to create a matrix. I will show you this in a minute. I can say, well, I know that all my elements are in the objects. I want to load them. And here I can say, well, I select a number of elements. And I say, well, display the matrix. And what it will do, it will show me a simple matrix view, and it shows me which associations are there between the various elements. I can also do this. I shall select a little bit less due to the time. I can say, well, show me the association types, and it will load again, and it will also show me what kind of association type is between the various elements. I let it load. Release notes, that's really an important one. When you add notes or release items or change items to elements within your Enterprise Architect repository, it will be available as a list of release notes here. And here it's easy for your customers to see what has been changed between various releases. So when you add a little bit of discipline within your modeling, and you add those changes to the changes you make within your repository, here you have an extra navigation option to see what the changes are. I don't know where in this example there are releases filled in. Yes, here you see, well, okay, here are some elements which are created, and here I have the possibility to navigate to the elements, and I can see which version ID is created. So here, a beautiful way of combining the various sections in Enterprise Architect for creating an attractive layout for non-modelers in EA. Important aspect of the WPP is that it's really data driven, and that it has the possibility for somebody who has the authorization for it, is that you can quite easily modify the content of the repository. And there is also a form factory, an Explorer view for defined. Currently, I have access as the custodian, the highest level, And what you see here is that I have access to the content of my dynamic viewer. For example, I see here a number of elements which are relevant. For example, the menus, the forms, the controls, and eventually the content. I will first show you the content. And here I can say, well, load my content. It will load my tree view. And here, for example, I say, well, the logical data model. I think I have done something wrong. I want to modify it. And I can say here, well, modify the content of this part. It's probably part of the start page. Yes, it's in the start page section. I can add here a kind of text. And here I can say, well, let's create something which is not EA Global Summit. And what I can say, well, I want to add some formatting. I want a heading 2 for this. And I can say, well, save this. And when I go to my logical page, you can see that the content is modified. So here you see that it's really easy to create extra information around your repository content and add information for specific use cases or for specific projects or for specific stakeholders. And of course, you can here create hyperlinks to the various elements in my repository viewer. But in the Form Factory, there is a little bit more, because what I can also do is that it's really easy, for example, to modify my menus. Again, filter. For example, the Form Factory, I think it's not a good name for my menu item. I can load it and I can say, well, the Form Factory is only relevant for custodians, so I want to have this in my menu name. And I can say, well, the title of the menu for custodians. And I can say, well, save it. And when I take a look, you see here that the element is modified. Load it again. I'll show you some details. I load the various elements to show you some details. For example, here my form is defined. And here you see that it's an entry form. But when I go to my previous page, you can see that there is also a control defined. In this case, based on my form search class, there's also a list class. And when you click on this element, it will load in my Form Factory. And here you see that you have the possibility to modify the SQL statement. And here you see a combination. You see the SQL statements and you see a control template. So here you see how you can combine a little bit like to compare like the static HTML generator. Here you see how you can use this, and this you can use for search pages, etc. An extra element, what you have here, is that you can add all kinds of extra information. And one of the last interesting things is that you can create multiple web levels. You can say, well, there are authorization levels. A guest is the lowest level, that's access for everybody. Login guest, guest logged in, participant, modeler, etc. And what you will see is that when you use these web levels, you can display or hide certain content, certain menu items, certain pages, even certain controls for specific users. So this is really powerful when you want to use this for getting access, giving access to people with more or less experience with data modeling. And the little bit information about the solution. I will stop this one. It's a relative simple structure, I think. It are a limited number of ASP.NET pages, and those ASP.NET pages, they are related with each other, and they have access to that that file, that repository file, where the background information of the WPP is available in. For example, I'll show you small piece of source code. This is a detail page, and when the page loads, it goes to the configuration manager, loads the connections to the various databases, and then it transforms all the information in your database, your repository database for the WPP, and it transfers it with the content for the specific situation. So it's always, and you can see it in the hyperlinks all the time, there is an ID, and based on that ID, there is a certain part of the information retrieved either from the WPP repository or from the Enterprise Architect repository. And this makes it possible to retrieve the data in an interactive way. This file, this solution, is included in the source code available on the Teams site. When you have Enterprise Visual Studio on your on a computer, you can open this solution. There's a solution file included, and you can start running, and then it will start the WPP based on the sample repository. The sample repository is available. Let me go back to my Visual Studio. It's available under the app data file. Here is the IDEA repository. It's a simple Microsoft database, but it can also be a SQL Server database or a MySQL database, whatever you want. Here is the repository, and also this can be an EAP or an EAPX file, or it can also be a SQL Server or a MySQL file, because when you look at the web config, you see that you have to create two connection strings, one to the WPP and one to the EAP file or to the SQL Server connection. It's even possible to create a schema within a SQL Server database, a special schema with the WPP tables, and then you create there the schema for the WPP file structure. And as you can see, there is in the solution initial file form factory SQL script, which gives you the possibility to create the relevant structure. I suggest we go back to where we stopped in the previous part for for generating. I will go to this element again, and I will show you as a last element of this session, the advanced solution. Here you see that there is a little bit more detail, for example, in the page template, but you also see that there are a number of extra things in the detail pages. And there is an interesting thing. I can create an extra HTML page, because when one of the templates has the extension HTML, it will create a specific file for it. Go back to generate, do not generate the PDF, and I will start publish. And here you see that it's running, but I can already display one of the pages. Let it load. And here you see that you have the elements in a more attractive layout. It's based on a bootstrap layout. And when I go to one of the elements, you will see that we have again created a little bit different layout. Let it load. Here we have a kind of a navigation section. And here with some background information about the person. Here I have the possibility to navigate to the various elements in my diagrams or to the related elements. But the most interesting element is here under the home page. And again, let it load. Here you will see that it's really easy to combine parts of your static HTML site with background information, with an interactive layout for your diagrams. Here you see parts of our website, and here you see that you show a number of diagrams in your static layout. And I can say, well, go to the details of this diagram. All relatively easy because it's here, it's in these elements. Here you say, well, here is my my header section. Here I want to have the list diagrams of my indexes, and here you see the SQL statement belonging to the elements, and here the details based on a bootstrap layout. A tip on creating these pages is what I mostly do is that I first create the layout of a number of pages. I have done it here in my templates part. You see that I have created a number of sample HTML pages based on that bootstrap layout that I create for one element, and then I transfer it to my screens in the report generator. I add the SQL statements to it, and that gives me the possibility to create a static HTML website in an attractive layout. Okay, I think this was the information I want to share with you. I want to notify the two web pages, the two pages on expertise, one for the WPP And this one for the static HTML generator within the ID generator, within the ID add-on. Please register, you will receive an email. And when you want to participate in the community and add functionality to it, please do not hesitate to contact me via mail or via the Teams site of this conference. So thank you for your attention. I don't know whether there is time for some short questions.
Thanks, Bert. It was a very interesting presentation indeed. We did go a bit over time, but the presentation was very useful. So everyone were sticking to it and were really keen to follow. I think the follow-up conversations can be continued in the Teams channel. But it was a very in-depth presentation, and there was a lot of options that people should have noticed. Thank you, everyone, for joining this session. I hope you found it interesting. So this is what is making this summit very special. So we have a variety of speakers, a variety of sessions, ranging from a very high-level, holistic, top-level view down to the most technical session that takes us to the trenches and shows us how to do the nitty-gritty. So, you know, it's been great to see this presentation. Thank you very much once again, Bert, and everyone for attending. So we'll continue our conversation in the Teams channel. Thank you.
Like yesterday, I will grab a cup of coffee and be back in 5 minutes in the team site.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Nizam.
Bye.
Bye.
Thanks again, everyone.